Hey everyone, I am Laura Kilgore with 2020 Mom, and I'm just going to do a quick introduction. That was my introduction. That was really quick. No. I'm Laura Kilgore, and yeah, I work with 2020 Mom as our social media lead, and I do a lot of our graphic design. Thank you so much for coming today, and welcome to this breakout session of improving maternal and child outcomes through quality prenatal mental health care. I am going to pass it on over to Olivia and Jessica to so we can enjoy their presentation.
Thanks so much, Laura. We'll go ahead and introduce ourselves, we'll introduce our talk first. So we will be speaking on graduate medical education for OBGYN trainees. A training framework for maternal mental health care. This was made possible by a grant we received in 2021. It was an 18-month grant, the Picker Gold Graduate Medical Education Challenge Grant from the Arnold P. Gold Foundation, which inspired us to really design an evidence-based curriculum on perinatal mood and anxiety disorders that we could teach to resident trainees, but also junior faculty like ourselves. It was approved by our NYU Research on Medical Education Outcomes Committee, as well as our OBGYN Departmental Quality Improvement Committee. And it was made possible thanks to a village of learners as well. So not just Dr. Vernon and myself, but some of our residents and medical students who really made this all possible. I am Dr. Olivia Myrick. I'm a clinical assistant professor at NYU Langone Health. I'm a generalist OBGYN in a high volume faculty group practice in a big major academic center along with Dr. Vernon. I have a master's in health professions education and with a specific interest in professional development of OBGYN trainees and our future doctors. I am the associate program director of the NYU OBGYN residency and will be taking over as the program director this fall and the education director of our OB perinatal mental health program in our own faculty obstetric practice, which we've built sort of from the ground up over the last 2 or 3 years, which we'll be talking about in conjunction with the education initiatives that we've been working on. Dr. Vernon.
Hi, I am Jessica Vernon. As Olivia mentioned, I am part of the faculty group at NYU Langone along with her, and I'm also the OB director of perinatal mental health, and just really excited to talk to you about this topic. I'm just going to give a little bit of background and context. I have been on maternity leave for almost 6 months at this point, so Dr. Myrick has taken the reins and really built out a lot of this grant work while I've been out. So she's going to do a majority of that talk. So it's very awesome that we have this wonderful team between the two of us and all of our supporters at the hospital. So I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with this infographic, considering the audience we have here. And we all know very intimately about the breadth and depth of perinatal mood and anxiety disorders. However, this was something that I didn't learn about until recently in my own training about a decade ago. I was only taught to look out for the most severe of cases, people who came postpartum and they were just very crying and sad and admitted to depressed or suicidal and kind of how to funnel them into psychiatry. But there was nothing with screening. There was nothing with talking to people or looking for risk factors. And so when I had my first baby almost 5 years ago and had severe postpartum anxiety and OCD, I had no clue. I just thought I was a hypervigilant new mom. And it went on for close to 2 years before New York became the epicenter of COVID. And then I kind of decompensated and developed depression on top of it and finally got the help I need. So when I recovered from my journey with PMEDS, I made it my mission to help others, increasing awareness and access and care. So I'm really passionate about this work from my lived experience. And luckily, Dr. Myrick has become very passionate about it along with me. Next slide. And this one, of course, is well known. This is from the wonderful 2020 Moms infographic, and really shows us how pervasive PMADs are. And we know that a lot of these statistics are from prior to the pandemic. So we expect even higher numbers now, and a recent large meta-analysis out of Massachusetts has showed us that it's closer to 1 in 3 postpartum and pregnant people are suffering from a PMAD. And with the increasing rates of anxiety and depression, we can just anticipate that this will continue to go up. Next slide. So for a little bit of context about our institution, as Olivia said, we are a large, high volume academic practice. And we do, post-pandemic, we've done about 2,200-2,300 deliveries a year. Prior to the pandemic, it was closer to 3,000. And that's just for our practice, not for the whole hospital. So using the estimates of the different PMADs, we extrapolated about how many people in our practice would be struggling with each of these, understanding that a lot of them are comorbid conditions. If we were to look at, and this is just people who gave birth, this does not include people who had miscarriages, pregnancy losses, infertility, that we are also seeing regularly in our practice. And if we were to look at current day, where we're closer to a third of people struggling with a PMAD, that would mean that at least 750 birthers a year in our practice are experiencing a PMAD, which is huge. And we knew that we were nowhere near capturing these people. Next slide. And as we know, from the risk factors, as we're also looking at kind of triaging and looking at who's high risk, because we have a very robust maternal fetal medicine group in our practice, and we have a top level NICU and fetal surgeons, we get people who have a lot of risk factors. They come in with underlying chronic medical conditions. They develop complications during pregnancy. Their babies have complications. They deliver preterm. Their babies go to the NICU. They experience more losses, more C-sections, more hemorrhages. So you can just imagine that we hypothesize that our rates in our practice are actually even a lot higher than the new rates of about 34% that we're seeing in the data. Next slide. So when we started looking at ways to improve the care pathway, of course, we looked at the research done by Nancy Baya and the team out of Massachusetts, which just has done so much for us and kind of seeing how we can improve things. And we know that it is a whole series of events that have to happen for patients to get the care they need and care that actually improves their outcomes by them achieving remission. So in our office, it was recommended that we do universal screening, both at the Glucola test and again postpartum. However, we knew that this wasn't universally being done, and even of those being done, how many people were being assessed by the provider, how many people were actually looking at the responses and talking to patients. And if they were doing so, how were they hooking them up in care? And when we started this work, we had an outdated referral list of therapists and psychiatrists to give to the patients, and they could take that and call people themselves. And most of the providers either didn't take insurance, might not be in their network, they might be closed to new patients, or had a very long wait list of 3 to 4 months, which we know is just way too long in the peripartum period. And so we were seeing what they see in the data here, where very few people are actually getting the care they need, and even less are achieving remission, which is improving maternal and child health outcomes. So we kind of brainstormed and thought of different ways where we could make the biggest impact and increase access the most. And one of the things that we did was educate ourselves. We used the Massachusetts Child Psychiatry Access Program algorithms, and information for primary care providers. We've done trainings through Cellini Institute, Postpartum Support International, and just really built strong relationships with our psychiatrists so that we felt more comfortable and knowledgeable managing uncomplicated patients and knowing who to refer to. And this was done as well as some other initiatives that we'll talk about later. But once we trained ourselves, we thought about training other junior faculty and residents so that we could really impact all their future patients as well. And I'll let Olivia take it over.
Exactly. I think just prior to this breakout session, they were speaking about different options and opportunities when it comes to screening. But as we sort of saw in that previous model, that's just the first step. And as two people, as OBGYNs and who are supposed to see a patient every 15 minutes all day, and that's it. Not only did we not have the education and knowledge, but we didn't really have the systems in place to actually be able to have effective screening protocols, to be able to take time to assess the patient and effectively triage. We didn't have an escalation process. We weren't comfortable initiating treatment because nobody had ever taught us how to, even though the vast majority, as we'll talk about, of patients who are being seen in an obstetric practice with risk factors, but not necessarily any complex medical history, your OBGYN is the perfect person to monitor your mood. And Dr. Vernon and myself sort of taking it on our own initiative to learn a little bit more because of the kind of devastating impact that we saw during COVID in New York City. Unfortunately, that's a rarity. And so trying to discuss, you know, how can we change the systems to sort of work in our favor so that we're able to provide effective mental health care to our patients as obstetricians just opened up a huge wealth of opportunities, which we've been trying to take sort of piece by piece. So for the majority of the rest of this hour or so, we'll kind of walk through what we have done over the last year and a half, and would love to get feedback and suggestions about what else we need to be considering or how else we can share what we've been doing so far. We knew that Dr. Vernon and myself knew that our own knowledge was lacking, but we needed to sort of assess if that was the case more broadly. We needed to identify how effective we were at utilizing the screening tools already in place. We needed to identify within our own practice who was comfortable triaging and escalating these issues, who felt that this was a priority similar to us. And we needed to identify where we were failing when it came to patient resources, because we had a kind of anecdotal experience, but sort of needed to look at things more broadly. So we needed to do a broader needs assessment. Then in terms of actually educating providers, we needed to identify what the core components would be of an ideal curriculum for OBGYN learners. There was not something standard at the time. You know, 2 years ago, there wasn't any standard curricula that we could easily pull from that spoke specifically to OBGYNs. We needed to identify what the best method of approach was to getting this information to busy OBGYNs who are seeing patients every 15 minutes in the office. And we needed to connect with experts in the field because we ourselves were not. We were people who were interested and motivated, but we had neither the knowledge nor the training to really be able to design something from the ground up at the start. And then lastly, and we'll kind of finish with this if we have some time, but it's impossible to talk about all of the steps that we've taken without seeing how it truly impacts the systems that are in place. And by educating providers and changing the screening process, we implemented a much more effective workflow of identifying, triaging, and escalating patients. We created what is now a collaborative care model, specifically at NYU, between psychiatry and obstetrics. And we're still very much wading through navigating. Even this morning, we were on an hour and a half Zoom about, you know, what issues we're still trying to overcome and systems that we're trying to fight in order to make this an effective initiative. So I'll take things sort of one by one. In terms of the grant that we received, it encompassed really performing a needs assessment and implementing a pilot curriculum, and then kind of gathering the information there and moving things forward to see what the impact was then clinically. So in terms of needs assessment, we were not shocked to find out that the vast majority of both junior faculty, so general OBGYNs, as well as resident physicians or resident OBGYNs, felt that their training, 100% felt that their training was either minimal or suboptimal with respect to the perinatal mood and anxiety disorders education that they had received up to that point. The vast majority of experiences came from patients themselves. So just like Jess and I, we only really learned things on the fly because we were encountering patients who had such a massive need that we were kind of using the time on nights and weekends to figure out what other resources we could pull from. And that's how the vast majority of OBGYNs learn how to manage this. which is a little scary. The vast majority of OBGYNs would prefer a didactic lectures or podcasts or something that they can sort of listen to on the fly. And while the majority did screen for depression, no one ever really screened for bipolar disorder, PTSD, or anxiety, which we find, especially in our practice, might be even higher than those with depressive symptoms. And then I think most significantly, 100% at the time that everybody was surveyed here at NYU were not comfortable managing. They would immediately refer to mental health specialists, which, as we know, with limited access to therapists, limited perinatal psychiatrists that have availability or accessible insurance options, that meant patients were really going nowhere. So this was very not surprising to see. The other component of the needs assessment was how were we doing with what we were supposed to be doing. So as OBGYNs, as Dr. Vernon mentioned, we should be screening for this. It's a standard practice for us to be screening for mood disorders or depression and anxiety, both during the pregnancy at a designated time, usually at the start of the third trimester, and then once in the postpartum period. The way that we previously did this, and I would venture to guess the vast majority of busy OBGYN practices are the same, is that there was this sheet of paper that sometimes was in the was in the room with the patient that they would have may or may not have filled out. And you may or may not have had time to review that with the patient and give it a score. And then if we found that the score was extremely elevated or question 10, which links to suicidality, was positive, we just told the patient that this seemed to be bad and we didn't really have anything else to give them. And that was so frustrating as OBGYN providers kind of mid-pandemic, as we saw such a rise in this, or we saw people who became more comfortable about coming forward with how they were doing from a mental health perspective in their pregnancy, we just had nowhere to refer them. And so we needed to identify if we were actually affected in even screening at the start. And not shockingly, we were terrible. So we did a retrospective chart review. Again, this is our very large faculty practice. And over a 6-month period, we assessed all patients who delivered at our hospital and attended their postpartum visit during this 6-month time. We then looked back and made sure that if they did receive antenatal care at our institution, we evaluated whether or not they were appropriately screened with this Edinburgh depression screen that is very commonly used by obstetricians, both during their pregnancy and after. And surprisingly, but sort of frustratingly, reviewed the results, which showed that only about half of the patients antenatally received a properly scored depression screen. There were about 12% of patients who were screened, but the results were never documented or reviewed by a provider. And about a third of encounters did not include depression screening at all. With this cohort of patients that we reviewed. Again, this was before any initiatives were taken by Dr. Vernon and myself in terms of the education of providers or the system changes. But we would argue that this is probably mirrored elsewhere in busy faculty practices. And especially when it comes to, you know, the vast majority of our patients being very high risk or having multiple risk factors for mood disorders, the fact that only half are being screened during their pregnancy is pretty devastating. And then postpartum, unfortunately, the results were similar. About 60% of patients received a properly scored depression screen. 16% of patients were screened, but the scores were never reviewed or documented. And a quarter of encounters entirely in the postpartum period did not include the depression screening that was supposed to be in place. So when we think about the amalgamation of factors that certainly contributed to this, yes, it was a cumbersome workflow with paper that didn't show up. It was not integrated into our electronic medical record in terms of anything that was easy to review. Again, all of these visits that we have are about 15 minutes in length, and usually that's shortened to 7 by the time that you're actually sitting with a patient. And there was nowhere to escalate. So even if the screening was appropriately performed, we just didn't really have any resources. And then the huge component is nobody really knew how to talk about this to patients, and nobody really knew how to manage it themselves. So we'll talk a little bit next about the education initiatives that we started because of all of this frustrating information that we found with our baseline assessment. But we'll speak to both the education of providers as well as the targeted changes in workflow. Currently, we're in the process of doing a statistical analysis on that patient cohort and the provider cohort in that 6-month period to identify if there are certain patient populations that are being missed, if there are certain providers that are or certain times of day where patients are often being missed with respect to mental health screening. We have started to dedicate time and effort within OB visits by specific providers who are trained to do so, solely to discuss mental health in pregnancy. And we've built out our collaborative care models, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But in terms of the education initiatives, this again was what the Picker Gold Medical Education Grant really incentivized us to pursue. And so our aims were to develop and implement a didactic series to educate obstetric learners, so resident physicians, on perinatal mood and anxiety disorders, and then to begin to assess the real world applicability of that educational curriculum. And we had so much interest when we were starting to do this for our residents that it was very easy to recruit junior faculty who was experiencing the same things that we were, who just wanted a little bit more knowledge and tools to be able to provide their patients. So in order to, as the one of the associate program directors of our OBGYN residency program, I was positioned to be able to kind of capture a subset of the didactic education about a year ago for the resident physicians and sort of say, you know, this is Women's Mental Health Month. And here are all of the things that we feel like you need to, that we feel like you need to know. And so over the course of about a year, we created a 10-hour pilot lecture series about perinatal mental health, and we delivered it virtually over about 4 to 6 weeks. Again, we did that baseline assessment survey and sort of separated out residents from junior faculty to assess their comfort level and knowledge prior to the intervention, and then we again did a post-analysis. We also did a post, after the intervention, we also performed an anonymous focus group, which I'll speak to as well, to again, really ascertain what the high yield information was and what we were still missing in terms of creating a curriculum that learners could really be comfortable with in terms of screening and managing and escalating appropriately when it comes to obstetricians managing perinatal mood and anxiety disorders. Similarly, about 100% of residents said that their training was quite terrible. 25% or fewer residents felt comfortable making perinatal psychiatric diagnoses other than postpartum depression. And again, all residents said that they would refer patients to mental health specialists instead of attempting to treat themselves. And this is just a sort of image about how their comfort levels when it comes to diagnosing, as you can see, kind of postpartum depression or non-obstetric depression, which just tends to be a little bit higher, but again, still not even close to the majority. And then vastly for the rest of identifying human trafficking, PTSD, bipolar disorder, anxiety, psychosis, absolutely uncomfortable identifying those things, let alone diagnosing, let alone managing. So the pilot lecture series, again, we pulled the curricular objectives from the NCRP, the National Curriculum in Reproductive Psychiatry, which is a group of wonderful humans that have really done some amazing and very in-depth work about training resources for largely psychiatrists. We worked with our perinatal psychiatrists at NYU to identify with them what do we think is the most relevant for OBGYN learners in terms of topics. And then we recruited the experts and sort of reached out to a lot of different people across the country, as well as at our own institution, to be able to speak a little bit more intelligently to some of these things and to provide us a bibliography of resources and to participate in a virtual but very kind of engaging and dynamic discussion with our residents at NYU. And after this, about 86% of residents felt much more familiar and comfortable, certainly with the screening tools utilized, definitely with the resources that they were able to provide. Their confidence in diagnosis improved, particularly for bipolar disorder and anxiety, which, as we know, is Very, very critical, especially if you're considering even managing any patient with mood changes in the peripartum or postpartum period. But it was important to identify that managing these disorders, their comfort levels really remained low. So about 30% of residents or fewer felt comfortable managing treatment, even after all of this information, which kind of led us to say, okay, if we need to revamp this curriculum, there needs to be a much greater emphasis on almost like simulation or practice when it comes to actually managing real life clinical situations. So there was a degree of involvement and engagement that the residents really weren't getting through our initial pilot lecture series. A lot more residents at that conclusion did say that they would be more comfortable initiating care themselves before referring to a mental health provider, but there were a lot of nuances and anxieties about the responsibilities of an OBGYN and sort of where did that line lie, which I'll speak to in a moment. The resident opinions on our lecture series were largely extremely positive. The speakers that were available to present to the residents here at NYU were extremely dynamic, were wonderful resources. The content was very thorough and evidence-based, and the only feedback that we got was, we would like more, please. And the mode of delivery was overall appropriate. This was a great thing to be able to learn or have access to virtually and then have it be recorded so that people could go back and reflect on the material. So the initial conclusions from this pilot lecture series was that there was as estimated, a deficit in OBGYN resident knowledge and comfort regarding perinatal mood and anxiety disorders that was somewhat improved by a focused lecture series, but there was greater emphasis needed on treatment and management. And so from there, we started workshopping kind of an even broader curriculum or some edits to the curriculum that we have. In order to get a little bit more context about how to frame the goals, we did a focus group with five residents who had participated in the lecture series. We have about 40 residents that were able to be exposed to this material. And five volunteered to participate in an anonymous semi-structured focus group after the completion. The interviews were done by our lovely medical students. They were anonymously transcribed, and then Dr. Vernon and I coded and analyzed the data and sort of found some common themes that kept popping up. So there were six overarching themes. About half had to do with the curriculum itself, and half had to do with sort of the reflection and the anxieties that this brought about in an OBGYN who is attempting to manage these issues in the midst of the other things that are required of an obstetrician. So there was a lot of comments and reflection on the current status quo and how the systemic limitations really prevent us from being able to do this effectively, even if we want to. And again, as I alluded to previously, there was a lot of discussion, like kind of spontaneous dialogue about what is our responsibility, certainly in terms of identification, but how far in terms of treatment? What if we feel out of our depth? What if we don't have the resources that we need? And so this really made us realize that in order to create an effective, if we're giving a true broader curriculum to OBGYN learners, the necessity for reflection and discussion about their own kind of perspectives in navigating this is really critical. And so to be able to have opportunity and space, not only just to internalize didactic information, but to also sort of reflect in themselves how effective they feel that they might be or what resources that they might need at their fingertips in order to feel like an effective provider and not feel like they're drowning. And then the other half of the overarching themes that popped up, they were able to identify the topics that were absolutely critical and that should perhaps get more airtime. They recommended edits specifically to the curriculum that we have, and they were able to directly link the curriculum to impacts on their own behavior over the subsequent 3 to 6 months of their residency, which was very cool to see. So I won't dwell on all of these details that popped up from the perspectives that we gathered from the focus group. But there was a really great satisfaction with the objectives that we delineated, which again were pulled from the NCRP. They requested opt-in material for deeper overview. They wanted more interactive resources, which we certainly could pair to the need for people to really practice managing in simulated situations. And they talked about limitations, particularly in residency training, the fear of misdiagnosis, the lack of follow-up, the lack of time. All of these things are very large hurdles to be able to mount, but we felt that if we started with the education piece, then particularly those, whether they're pursuing a generalist career or high-risk obstetrics or fertility or oncology, and these are essential tools for any OBGYN provider to have in terms of knowledge. And it's and it was just mind-blowing that this wasn't a standard prior to this point. I'll go ahead and move forward here in the sake of time. But one of the most wonderful and unforeseen things that sort of came out of this project was in our desperate attempt to recruit and find experts and talk to more people and figure out what we needed to know ourselves, let alone what we needed to teach to OBGYN residents. We were able to connect with people in the National Curriculum in Reproductive Psychiatry, the writers that are largely reproductive psychiatrists themselves, as well as some maternal fetal medicine specialists and general OBGYNs, just a broad group of wonderful people who's very motivated in disseminating the information that they have. And they were already in the midst of creating a curriculum, ideally for obstetricians, when we bumped into them, and we've been able to sort of collaborate with the sort of informal blessing of the president of ACOG, our kind of American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists, Dr. Ifa Paskins, who we pulled in for a couple of meetings with them to sort of say, you know, how can we align on this and how can we get all this material to the OBGYNs who desperately need it? So it started with 7 or 8 of us, but I'm pretty sure there's about 20 at least on the team now that are kind of dividing and conquering all of this material sort of that they were already working with. And then we were able to bring the perspectives from our own pilot curriculum to really structure an evidence-based larger curriculum with reflection components, with clinical practice components, with didactic education material really created by the experts. And we were able to chat with the representatives from our CREOG team, which is like a Council for Resident Education in Obstetrics and Gynecology, who publishes curricula nationally for use for OBGYN trainees, who's super excited about taking this material and disseminating it more broadly once it's finalized, and it's very close to being so. So this was just kind of an exciting offshoot. You know, we thought we were just sort of stumbling around in the dark, pulling in a couple pieces of information that we could disseminate to our own residents very locally, and it's grown into something much larger and more exciting than that. So we're very, very excited about where things will still go. We'll speak a little bit about changing the systems, and just please feel free to jump in at any point here. But obviously, in order to impact change here, we start with screening, we start with education, but there's so much more than that. So we have so much more work to do. And I want to speak a little bit to the systems that have changed as we have increase the awareness and program support, really, for taking a little bit of onus on ourselves as obstetric providers to provide mental health care for our patients. So we obviously began with education, but the next step was really looking at the outpatient setting, and that's what we're currently almost done perfecting in our own institution. And what we are just beginning to start is really the inpatient workflow, and all of these three components are what is truly essential to creating an actual model that is effective in both identifying and funneling patients into the care that they need for the obstetric side of things.
I'm happy to take over for a little bit.
I'll have you do it.
Let Olivia take a sip of water.
That's great. Thanks.
So as many of you are familiar with, collaborative care models have been really integral in primary care settings in improving access to care and really destigmatizing care, especially to mental health. And this is from the University of Washington Ames Center, where they have just been publishing data for a couple decades now about the great work you can do with a collaborative care model. And so looking at that, we kind of said, what can we do in our own office setting? It won't directly mimic this, but what can we do to create a system where when we do diagnose someone, we can immediately get them looped in care? And so this was the original model we proposed. Collaborative care models do revolve around a behavioral care manager, and they are the kind of linchpin in the system, making sure that nobody's falling through the cracks, people are getting appropriately escalated that need it, everyone has their appointments. And so the goal was to have everyone funneled in through them with an elevated depression screen, a positive suicidality question. And then they would kind of send them on their way to the therapist, which is a licensed clinical social worker in our office, or the OBGYN for pharmacotherapy, or both, or if they needed the higher level of care, the reproductive psychiatrist. So this was the model that we introduced to the administration and leadership in the OBGYN department to hopefully get approval and funding to create the system in our own practice.
And I think it's important to say that there was none of this. We really didn't have a relationship with reproductive psychiatrists. We didn't have a licensed clinical social worker. We still don't really have a care coordinator and are kind of doing it ourselves. But because we started talking about how important this was in terms of education, because we started escalating to the administration how poorly we were doing with respect to screening, and because we fought very loudly sort of saying that the numbers were there and we just were not treating or reaching these people, they were able to listen a little bit and able to kind of dedicate a couple people onto our team.
Yeah. So we got approval to hire a full-time therapist who specifically works with our perinatal patient population, and she only sees patients in our office. We also got approval for funding with the Department of Psychiatry to have a reproductive psych fellow who is overseen by two amazing repro psych faculty members at our organization, and they spend 2 days a week in our office, 2 days in the psychiatry office, and a day on the floor in the hospital seeing patients. And then we also have had more dedicated nursing and schedulers so that when patients need appointment for therapy or medication, we're not just kind of reaching out in the dark. We have people who we know we can directly go to and get help. And also when patients are calling in and saying that they're experiencing symptoms, there is a nurse there who is able to kind of triage them and help get them funneled into the system.
And then the other thing that we had struggled with was that we didn't have any escalation protocols. So even if we did take the initiative to do the screening and to go through this with the patient, we didn't really have anywhere to go. And now we have a very clear escalation protocol for all of our OBGYN faculty that when these depression screens are performed, if they receive over a certain number, so between a 10 and a 19, particularly in the utilization of an Edinburgh depression screen, they're automatically counseled as to whether or not they would like an appointment with our licensed clinical social worker, our therapist in the office, or if they are interested in medication, then they are referred for it to, and they have a fairly low risk factors, then they are referred to Drs. Vernon or myself or other OBGYNs who have time dedicated in their schedule just for mental health provision for our prenatal and postpartum patients, and who have done a little bit more of the training of the maternal mental health certification, the PSI courses, Cellini Institute courses, et cetera. And then if their Edinburgh depression screen is over 19, or if they have a positive screen for suicidality, or if they have a complex psychiatric or psychosocial history, they are automatically referred to see our perinatal psychiatric fellow, which, as Dr. Vernon said, is in our office now twice a week. We also meet weekly, Thursday mornings, all of us on the team in an interdisciplinary sort of care meeting to discuss any high-risk patients or people we feel like are falling through the cracks, and to basically a triage where patients, where and how quickly patients should be seen and by whom. And then another huge year in the making was as of March 1st, now all at NYU in our faculty group practice obstetrics offices, all of our perinatal mood and anxiety screening tools are now integrated into Epic, into our electronic medical record, such that when a patient arrives both for their initial prenatal visit, as well as their third trimester kind of designated period of time where we often will repeat screening, as well as their postpartum visit, they on check-in automatically are pushed a notification to fill out in both an Edinburgh depression screen survey, and then in the setting of their initial prenatal visit when they're establishing with us for the first time, they also fill out a survey surrounding their history of anxiety, their possible risk factors for bipolar disorder, and their own mental health history and whether or not they have a current therapist, which I believe is, as someone was saying in the previous lecture just prior to this breakout session, kind of identifying people at the start of where, if they've been on medication in the past, even the remote past, if they've been in therapy in the past, even remotely. This is something that's really important for OBGYNs to know, and this just wasn't a question that we were asking. And so the fact that it's now in our electronic medical record and pulled into the prenatal visit notes is a huge game changer, because it totally revamps how we're able to target the patients that are coming through our office and identifying those who might be at risk. And then because we now have the accessibility and the education of the providers who now know how to speak about this a little bit more, we are kind of offering the patients all of these resources at the start instead of struggling to find the resources once somebody is already very lost. And then the last thing is that we are changing not only the workflows, the team, the escalation protocols, but we're also changing just the visible presence. And this was something that we really learned from the residents when we did this pilot program, just the act of talking about this stuff, of prioritizing it, changes people's thought process in terms of what is important in obstetrics. And we know from everybody who's speaking today and yesterday, compared to gestational diabetes, like it has nothing on maternal mental health, and it has to be part of our standard in the way that we're evaluating patients, in the way that we're thinking about labor, in the way that we're thinking about postpartum care, and just the physical presence of these educational materials of perinatal psychiatry, who has since just become essential to our functioning in this program, certainly. And that door just never had previously been opened. So the perinatal psychiatrists, both those two fellows that we now have, as well as the designated attendings whom we all were very, very close to, they round on the antepartum and postpartum floors twice weekly. The fellows are physically in our office twice weekly. We've updated mental health packets, research resources, brochures for patients for like 10 years. We probably had the same list of outdated therapists that weren't taking insurance in New York City. And now we've completely revamped it and are changing things every 3 to 6 months to make sure that everything is up to date for our patients. Again, we have those weekly multidisciplinary meetings, and we have the educational resources and the initial pilot lecture series that we did for our OBGYN residents. That is available to all of the junior faculty at all across the NYU institution. And again, we're collaborating with a much larger, much more intelligent group of people than us to make a curriculum that's much meatier and much much more capable, much more apt to be able to be disseminated to all OBGYN learners across the country. We are beginning to collaborate inpatient with the NICU providers and the social workers, recognizing that patients with babies who are admitted into the neonatal ICU or the social workers inpatient on the floor often catch things that we as the OBGYNs don't see. And so creating a dialogue and an escalation protocol on the inpatient side has become our next huge project. And hopefully with the improvement of screening measures in both inpatient and outpatient settings, in addition to all the educational initiatives that we're doing, hopefully we're creating a playbook for other OBGYN providers, other generalists who feel like they can't do anything. But with just a little bit more education and dialogue and just slightly more resources and time, which is very difficult to get, but certainly needs to be made a priority in a much bigger way. So we'll sort of end there. And I think this is kind of perfect. It's about, I think we have 20 more minutes or so. So hopefully we've got some time for some questions and some back and forth. We're hoping to work with the NCRP to create a collaborative curriculum and submit it to our kind of educational organization for wider dissemination for all OBGYN learners. We're in the midst of writing down again our playbook to be able to sort of give to anyone who's interested about how to really sort of build this from the ground up. But it definitely starts with provider education and motivation internally. And then we are right now only able to access patients in the peripartum period. But we would argue that, again, as OBGYNs, whether it's oncology or fertility or family planning, mental and emotional support should be deeply integrated into women's health and OBGYN care in general. And it previously just hasn't been a priority. And we're seeing this more and more as we talk about maternal mortality or access to reproductive health services. I mean, there is such an emotional and mental health component to this that providers need to be educated upon about how to speak to it and how to care for it and how to escalate things that need to be escalated to the experts in the to the experts they have access to. So thank you so much. Again, thanks to our village that has helped us really create this. And we'd love to hear people's thoughts.
Amanda. You know, I was going to say Amanda's on here. She's
your name was on that slide a while back.
Hi guys. I was eating lunch. I didn't want you to see.
Totally like,
hi. I didn't want everyone to watch me like shove food in my face.
Amanda's one of our amazing colleagues from UCSF who's a maternal fetal medicine specialist and has been a member of NCRP and really helping to guide this curriculum from the OB side. So we're super excited that she's here. If we have any questions on that end.
I guess I wanted to address one thing that came up in the chat, which I think is super important, is this like this gap between, you know, what we're doing to address the lack of education among like medical students, residents, fellows, and how there's this like whole cohort of attending providers who don't have the education. So it's like, okay, well, what do we do when we're in this like weird liminal space where we have the junior folks who are probably more educated than their attendings. So there is a grant that we're writing to get funding to have a train the trainers event that we will probably just try and fund ourselves if we don't get the grant, to educate attending providers so that they also learn the curriculum. So I guess point being that like, even though it's designed for trainees, it will be available to and delivered to other folks who are attending level providers.
And I actually, this is Seema Bajaj at Seleni, and I kind of echo that same sentiment. I think it's great that the focus and the future is the residents and students, but there's also the faculty, right? And I think of it in so many levels, like the faculty, what they face. Most of the faculty, even junior faculty, are going through their own maternal issues, right? Miscarriage, loss, going back to work, seeing a pregnant patient, seeing, you know, or going to a pediatrician, going to see a newborn. I just think there's so much we can do. And it's just so nice to hear that this is a good start, because it's actually something I'm really passionate about, is kind of getting into grand rounds and getting into curriculums and giving faculty, residents, students, all just kind of like basic tools to improve their empathy, improve their bedside manner, because you all get rated on, you know, the Prescani and the bedside and the quality and this and that. And then like, no one really tells you, well, how do you speak to a patient when they've just miscarried? How do you speak to a resident or your colleague when, you know, what's the wellness look like? You send them home, you know?
Yeah.
What do you do with a pediatrician who's 6 months pregnant and has fetal demise at 6 months and has a full panel of patients who now every time we see her ask her, you know, how's the baby? What's the baby's name? Like, there's just so much missing from, and then we expect clinicians to take care after they've been through these things of the people who need the care and have that empathy and have that perspective. And I just think that there's so much missing, but of course I'm just stating the problem and not giving a solution, but like, I'm really happy to hear even some of this and happy to work with any of you guys if you're interested in like developing more and developing curriculum content, et cetera, to move stuff.
Well, the Cellini Institute has great, I did both the perinatal loss and the PMADS training before I did the PSI training, and they're wonderful, wonderful lectures, wonderful tips on talking to patients when they're going through any of these situations. And we totally agree. We've had a lot of conversations with NCRP about the art of the conversation. Correct. And how do we incorporate in this in the curriculum.
Yeah.
And the curriculum will be multi-layered, which Olivia can speak to a little bit more, because there will be residents who can only digest and only want to digest a smaller amount. And there will be ones that can take the time outside to add in to read these additional articles and maybe do some listening if we do some oral sessions on this is how you should talk to patients if they're going through this situation. And there's just so many different add-ons that we could do, and we're trying to think like, what do we do for the initial launch, and then what can we add on to make it more robust later, so we at least get this initial set of objectives out there as soon as we can.
That was one of the things that we learned from that resident focus group. It was like, give me the verbiage, give me the words to use so that I know how to speak to patients that are going through these things. And that's such a unique, again, when we think about how we learned, it was on the fly, nobody taught us, but that's an easy thing to teach from the experts who know, to be able to have, and that was one of our thoughts maybe for like supplemental curricular materials, to really have a podcast segment, you know, 20, 30 minute discussion between an OBGYN and a specialist in the field of whatever we're discussing, about how do I say this? What happens if I encounter this situation? What are the best words to use? I think that's a very unique thing that I'm sure applies to a lot more than just perinatal mental health. It probably is something that we could educate ourselves in a lot of different avenues. But that's one of the main things that we realize, like, that will resonate and that will stick with learners. And then to your point about the junior faculty, that those are the people who are the most motivated, not just junior, senior faculty who certainly didn't have this training. Actually, Jess, if you remember, we presented maybe 2 years ago on this to our department, and about how necessary it was to change things before we actually changed them. And I have, maybe it was someone very high up in the department who was like, this isn't our job. And we were like, well, yeah, we would argue that it is. And so it's tough to get buy-in even from, you know, senior OBGYN faculty who sort of think, you know, this isn't in our wheelhouse. And if we're being honest, yeah, we're the most primed people to be able to really discuss this with patients, perhaps begin a little bit of treatment, and then certainly funnel them into resources and escalate things appropriately.
Mm-hmm. Lauren, I don't know if you want to go through questions or have us. I know there's some hand raised, there's some stuff in the chat.
Yeah. I'm loving the conversation in the chat, how there's like this separate thread happening. But Christina, since your hand's been up for a bit, I think it makes sense for us to pass it on to you so we can hear your question.
Oh, I didn't even realize my hand was up. Did you say Seema?
No, I'm sorry, Christina. I think
sorry,
she's,
sorry.
There we go, now she's unmuted.
Hi.
She's
like a little baby. There might be a fussy baby in the background. My office right now is my bed. I just had a baby. Ed, I have a question and a comment. First of all, absolutely blown away by what you all have accomplished. I mean, just incredible. And thank you so much for sharing. And I'm gonna drop the baby. Sorry. It's hard to hold a phone and a newborn at the same time. So I'm wondering if for the counseling part, because my background, just quickly, I've done research on kind of pregnant women's health beliefs and behaviors and how they're influenced by provider counseling. And my research and other research has basically said, even when providers try to counsel, it's not very effective and it's not usually well received. So even when obstetricians have valuable information, the communication part, it gets lost in communication. And so motivational interviewing is kind of the best that I've found for that. And I'm wondering if that's the approach that you're kind of looking at too.
Yes. So we found that too. It's not only, I think the education really comes down to teaching providers how to identify and appropriately escalate. And then there's only really a certain subset of providers who is comfortable, competent, and confident in performing this type of interviewing. I think this is also why there are a lot of OBGYNs who sort of say, this isn't my job, this isn't my strength. And I think it's important to acknowledge that perhaps in the system that we've created, the first thing is time. So I think the reason a lot of obstetric providers probably come off a little briskly or aren't really creating a space for someone to really open up emotionally is because the structure of our practice doesn't really allow for that. And so the way that we've structured things now, if someone is identified as having an issue, I have now 2 or 3 45 minute blocks per day that are solely mental health consultations of currently pregnant patients, which is huge. And it was a really difficult thing to advocate to our upper levels for that. But we argued that the need is there, the patients are there, and all we need is the space to be able to create that kind of culture of safety within a visit, which in a 10 to 15 minute visit, you really can't do
that. And we can bill outside of the global perinatal fee, which, you know, we needed to be able to build to get that time for sure.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. And I think just, I mean, not to offer unsolicited advice, but to, like, the time issue is always, you know, the first obstacle, but I think effective, like, evidence-based counseling methods take less time. And so you can kind of make an argument that, like, well, if you're using this, you know, particular way, rather than just kind of using a script, you can get straight to the point of, like, what does this patient need? Like, in my recent obstetric, you know, experience, I had a wonderful provider who gave me maybe 20 or 30 minutes of his time about nutrition and health. And I'm like, never once did he ask, like, what do you do for a living? I'm like, I could have told him I counsel on exactly what you're talking about, you know? So it was just an interesting experience of, like, if not really starting where I was at, rather just gave kind of the standard script.
Yeah. And there's always, I'm always telling the residents and med students too, like, find those attendings who are good at talking to patients. There's a couple MFMs where I know when they go in the room, I want to be there when they counsel my patient if I'm on labor and delivery, because I just know the way they talk is just amazing. And I'm able to ingest and incorporate some of that. And the same with our psychiatrist. If I'm on the floor when they're counseling someone, I'm there. And so I can hear how they're validating, how they're creating space, how they're asking open-ended questions, and really all of these techniques that have given me a lot of skills that I didn't have in my training. So, you know, I think our learners, they understand the value of this, and they are really seeking out this knowledge as well. And so I'm really hopeful from what we've seen, how much they want to participate and be involved in this research, and are really excited to be more holistic care providers that will have a generation coming up that is much more adept than we are.
I love that. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
There's a good question in the chat that we're currently navigating, so would love the perspective on it. But Tiffany Lentz said that as an RN educator, I find it challenging to get buy-in to mandate screening for all inpatients prior to discharge and change that policy. That is obviously the thing that we've tackled at last. And I think we really needed a something that was fully formed in the outpatient setting to be able to refer people to for follow-up before we could even consider inpatient screening. But it was one of the things that came up the earliest actually from labor nurses. So labor and delivery nurses and postpartum nurses were the main kind of voices in the room that sort of said, there has to be some sort of policy here other than this patient seems anxious. Should we get her a social work consult or should we get her a psych consult? Often it's the nurses who have been with the patient throughout the labor course who are seeing things that might be red flags or that might be a sign that someone needs a little bit more mental health support, whether in the inpatient or outpatient setting. So it was really nursing motivated that they were calling for certain screening tools or scores. I don't know if Lisa Tremaine is still on, but we've chatted with her about different ways to implement screening mechanisms in the hospital. And I think one of the components is not only someone's history, et cetera, or current emotions or state of mind, but it's the trauma perhaps surrounding delivery. And if whether or not the baby was admitted to the NICU, I think there is so much that is rolled up into mental health in the immediate postpartum period that I don't know if it's necessarily a screening that the patients need to fill out or a scoring tool for nurses to help kind of figure out who to escalate and how. But we do not have a system in place yet, and we are trying to figure out what the most effective one might be. But the interest is definitely there, which is huge, both from nursing and provider sides. So very interested to see what people have been doing elsewhere.
Oh, great. Amanda said that they're working on screening for antepartum patients.
Yeah, I was just going to say, like, kind of to piggyback on what Olivia mentioned, like, we struggle with, like, is it even the right thing to do a screening on somebody who's newly postpartum in the more traditional sense of screening? Like, I think there needs to be some kind of attention given to a patient's emotional health in the context of their delivery admission, but I'm not sure that like a PHQ, an EPDS, or a GAD is really like the right answer for that. But I do think, like, especially for the longer term antepartum patients, like, we are really missing the mark, especially for folks who have like PPOM at 26 weeks and stay until 34. So we're trying to figure out how to implement screening. We technically have a screening program, but like it doesn't get done, right? Because there's so much else going on. But on the postpartum side of things, we're trying to figure out a way for the bedside nurse to identify patients who would benefit from a touch point with an LCSW, either during their admission or after discharge. And we basically came up with like a list of things. So like unexpected NICU admission, expected NICU admission, postpartum hemorrhage, whatever it is, and offer those patients an opportunity to connect with social work and then do the more formal screening and then connect them to other resources as needed.
That's probably the best.
Yeah. Yeah. I definitely now incorporate in my postpartum rounding. I know, like, if patients have risk factors and talk to them about that and say, these are the things to look out for, but also just talking to every patient, because we know trauma is in the eye of the beholder, right? So I had one patient come to her postpartum visit and I was like, oh, you had a stat C-section. How are you feeling about that? She's like, that was fine. I'm traumatized from the Foley balloon insertion when they were inducing me because there were like multiple residents and a midwife and then an attending, and it was just torture. And so I actually went back to the residents and talked to them about that and say, you know, we have to look at every aspect of the care as this interaction with this patient. And, you know, if they're feeling violated, if they're feeling centered. And so, you know, it's really important for us not to just look at the risk factors, but validate everyone that even if you had a beautiful vaginal birth, you might be traumatized by the experience.
Yeah. And the more that we're talking about that, the more we're realizing that that's the case. Mm-hmm.
This has been a really great conversation. As someone who's gone through this personally, like the Foley bulb thing, that was the worst part for me too. So, but I just want to let you guys know, we just have a few minutes left. We have about 5 minutes left. So if there's any burning questions still, now's the time to bring those up.
And Seema, we can definitely connect offline because I know you're very passionate about this and it looks like you've done a lot of work on your own too. So we can definitely, I guess, I'm just going to put my email in the chat for anyone who wants to connect.
Yeah,
Please feel free.
I can't remember if you said it, was this program that you offered an elective or was it part of their core curriculum or how was it administered?
That's the goal, is to create a formal elective. And now that we have the system in place, we can. We have a medical student who's actually doing it right now. In terms of the like actual curriculum, the didactic material that we did as part of the pilot lecture series, that was part of resident didactic. So the OBGYN residents have 3 hours once a week where they attend basically classes or simulation or education sessions. And so I kind of hijacked a month and we just
got it.
We had a dialogue every Friday for 2 or 3 hours, specifically about perinatal mood and anxiety disorders and mental health.
That's amazing. Thanks.
And the what we're speaking about in terms of what we'd like to submit this now much stronger curriculum to, the like CREAG, the Council for Resident Education in Obstetrics and Gynecology, they sort of have downloadable curriculum, curricula on a variety of topics. So I think they have one on social justice as an OBGYN. And so you can download material that encompasses whatever it might be, 6 hours, 10 hours, that has all the PowerPoints really kind of ready to go, that any lecturer can be able to provide, that usually has supportive reading materials and reflection components. So we are designing this bigger curriculum with NCRP to sort of model after that so that, again, anybody can really use it. And then the fun part is the supplemental material, which we think a lot of providers would just like to listen to about the words to use and the reflection that really is so necessary as an OBGYN, especially as a learner, but as an OBGYN in general and navigating what our role is in all of this. Thank you so much for that. I want to copy all of this in the chat and save it.
Well, if we don't have any more questions, then I think it's okay to wrap up. If Olivia, if you have any closing remarks, or Jessica, and then you guys get a little bit of time back before we have our networking sessions.
Thank you. And look at Chris, is it Christiana or Christina? Christiana,
yeah.
Multitasking, new yeah.
This is just such a great conference. I came last year, and honestly, when the impetus for me signing up was this specific lecture, and it didn't disappoint. And I'm so grateful for you guys and what you're doing. I think provider education is like the forefront of what needs to be addressed. You know, because like you talked about this current staff, like they've already had their education. It's kind of hard, like this is a really bad saying, but it's hard to teach an old dog new tricks, you know? And my wife is a surgical oncologist in the military, and it's definitely a man's world, you know, I hate to say that. and they can be really hard to sway, but I feel like obstetrics, you know, and sorry, I didn't mean to go off on this tangent, but I just feel like there might be more room for and more openness in you know the early education to really make a real change. So
we've definitely
grateful for what you're doing.
We've definitely seen it at our institution. Laura, can you maybe give our emails out in like the general chat board or something? So if
people that you guys should be able to find everything in Whova.
Okay. Just if anyone wants to connect and collaborate, we're always
Under your own like each of you your own kind of like profile, your own account in there, you can add as much or as little information as you want.
Okay, cool.
So then
Olivia is about to go out on her maternity leave.
Yay, congratulations.
We're swapping out.
Yeah.
Jess is coming back. My second experience was so much better than the first because I did have the resources and support. So it's just like I can see what happens when we get people the right care.
Absolutely.
Amazing.
My first one was a teaching hospital, and it was chaotic, and there was a ton of people, and I related to that trauma story of like the trauma was just feeling like I was on display, you know, in bright lights and 20 people in the room and not knowing what was happening. My second one, it was me and my OB, a couple of nurses, dimmed lights, you know, and like I felt heard and understood, and it was a completely different experience.
And so these are the things we need on the audio recordings that we make for the residents.
Yes.
Those That's sort of stories. Important. Yeah.
The real stories about real people who have absolutely real experiences that, even though you've done this 20 times in the last 3 hours, like this is someone's first time, and you have to have that knowledge and that that awareness. And again, the verbiage that you use and the manner that you go about things is even more important than the clinical work that you're doing sometimes. It's huge.
I'll just add in, like, thank you to both of you. You're doing amazing work. And yes, like being a provider in the field is not protective, for sure. And I think it sometimes leads to like either even further silence, because we feel like, you know, my kids are almost 19 and 16 and a half, you know, and that was kind of what brought me into this. I'm a women's health nurse practitioner, and then went back for a psych NP and in amidst
amazing
the work that I did here too.
What state are you in?
New Hampshire.
Okay, cool.
I'm originally from New Jersey, though, then was in Boston. And so I know lots of, I've been doing like Nancy Byatt's work. And
New Hampshire, that's what we're trying to recreate.
we have a lot of, waiting for HRSA grant. Perinatal psychiatric access would be awesome.
But I totally agree. That was one of the things that sort of came out of the woodwork when we started talking about this more at our own institution, the emails that we got from other providers, other obstetric providers, much more senior than us, you know, saying, God, how much I would have needed you guys. Like this is, you know, we are not immune. And it was, it was really amazing. Yeah. It's amazing to see how, as someone who is doing bit by bit, just creating that space for our patients, the impact is so huge with just a little bit of intervention and time. It's really wonderful to see how tangibly this impacts our patients, even with just a little bit of education.
I tell all my medical assistants, make sure there's tissue boxes in my rooms, because when I do my visits, I'm like, how are you? How are you feeling? And you break through that facade and everyone's like, the breastfeeding is so hard, or this or that, you know, there's just so many aspects that you're not prepared for. And so it's like,
you need to give permission for that. And I would say even, and also that I think, and Seema, I think had touched on it as well, is like the lived experience of you guys as providers in this space and the unique challenges that come with that. And my kids are a little bit older now, but I would say like the younger doctors that are coming in that are having babies and stuff, like you guys, this is hard. This is like, it's gotten harder. like, you know, COVID, all the things, like it's a different social media, all of the, there's just a lot of it more intensity on everything.
Olivia and I were just talking this morning and yesterday about how she can work as program director to make it more comfortable for people to have babies during residency, because they like work until the end and come back after 6 weeks to stay on track. And it's just,
we're going to be over.
For disaster. It's hard. That's just, no.
That was a big topic in the national meeting, the APCO CREAG meeting. Like, how do we create, I went to a breakout session on like, how do we, like, what's the standard in terms of allowing OBGYNs postpartum recovery. And there were no solutions presented. No. So I think that is a world that we need to kind of tackle next.
I'm looking at Amanda's thing in the chat.
I feel like it's shameful. Like, I actually think it's like one of the great shames of our profession. We are so bad to our pregnant and postpartum trainees. And it is shameful.
And we are high risk people, right? We are by nature high risk for having complications, physical and mental. it's related to branded.
I think also the generations before you, since they've also had to, like, you know, kind of elbow out of the way, a lot of in a more male dominated profession as in medicine, like, I think the mentality was like, I just need to like push through it. And that doesn't work, obviously, but it's like, there's needs to be more. I am so glad that we're having these conversations around this finally.
For anyone who wants to learn how to get things done in the hospital, Lisa Tremaine is just amazing. She started the Bloom Foundation. She has created a huge PMed center in Jersey, like from nothing. I've seen it. She's like the mom whisperer. Like when I was postpartum, she was texting me to make sure I was okay this time. Just like connect with her. She will tell you how, as a nurse, she was able to build something incredible.
Yep. She was our inspiration. I think that was what you were one of the first people, Lisa, that we connected with via, you know, let's Google people and then email them and see if they'll talk to us. You were one of the first. And that was such a great inspiration of like, here's how to build something from nothing when nobody has your back. Like, let me show you how I did it.
She got the old white men in the administration to give her money.
They make them cry first, and then they will give me money or rooms. Rooms are just
learning your ways. We're just crying first.
And I have a psych MP student with me now, and she had a baby in October, and she was back at work with the baby with me in 13 days. And she could bring the baby, and she would, how she kept going, but we all became aunties. And if it was bad stuff, we held on to OB. And if it wasn't bad, OB went in to all the appointments too. And she's like, I would never have kept on track. I would never have been able to stay. And that's so sad. We're in women's health.
I know. It's worth it.
You guys did great. I feel like a proud mom. So happy.
Thanks, everybody. Please give us your wisdom. Let us know how we can be better. Let us know sort of what we need to be thinking about as we move forward. Hopefully there's certainly so much more work to be done. And but it's such a wonderful network of people that we really stumbled upon. And so it's all a group effort. We're kind of learning from everybody. So thank you.
So good. Bye, guys.
Bye. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.